thank you, Pritha. Thank you, ActionAid, for giving us this opportunity. I think as a panel, we've all, benefited greatly from listening over the last 2 days to everybody who's spoken here. And I think something that we all sort of were thinking about and which has come out very sharply over the discussions in the last 2 days has been this question about who constitutes the worker and, you know, what constitute working conditions under these changed circumstances. Pritha had also flagged off this question of how there is a blurring of the question of formality and informality, and we've had many academic debates about this question of duality and continuum, but I think we are at a historical juncture where we have really seen the incursions of informalization into even what were seen as secure formal domains at one point of time. To that extent, then, we can say that, you know, how we have sort of theoretically thought about what constitute relations of production now have to be reworked a little bit, because who constitutes the worker and, you know, what constitutes work itself is now going through a sort of paradigm shift, both within the formal and informal sector. In our first session that we had on our first day, when we had speakers from the formal sector unions talking to us, as well, you know, there was this question of the incursions of privatization, the high degrees of contractualization of work, and with this increasing amount of subcontracting of work, you know, who is a worker? Are you a worker? Are you an entrepreneur? Are you self-employed? Are you a independent contractor? All of that begs the question then of who are you really employed by, and what are the responsibilities that the employer holds towards you? With the informal sector, we find that there is an entire degree of neglect, invisibilization of kinds of work that is happening on the one hand, and on the other hand, a narrative by the state that we can see very clearly towards actually just shutting down the informal and promoting their notion of the formal, which of course tends towards the market and preferences, capital over labor at every juncture. So when we're discussing this question, therefore, of, you know, the worker and work itself, something that came up through our discussions over the last 2 days has been this question of what constitutes the dignity of work? What are the kind of conditions of work that we are discussing when we are talking about the worker itself? So beyond just, you know, the question of compensation, which itself is tricky terrain, because we of course find that there are a whole section of workers who are, you know, trying to get classified as workers and not as independent contractors, etc. There is another set of workers who are looking not to be classified, in terms of workers receiving a wage, but want to receive, say, compensation in terms of commissions. How we negotiate this terrain requires a great amount of rethinking and re-strategizing on our part. If we think about this in terms of what is actually the terms of compensation that workers are getting today, whether that be in the formal or informal sector, and if we try and think about it through what Nirmal was talking about yesterday about bondage and an expanded notion of bondage where, you know, even just receiving a minimal sort of wage that allows for basic survival constitutes a form of bondage, then we are really talking about a very difficult time that we find ourselves in, where a whole section of the working class population finds itself on this kind of brink of servitude, of bondage, whether that be in the formal or the informal sector. And negotiating that question, strategizing and putting our questions for how much we are owed as workers in that sense, becomes even more difficult when we have to think about this through the prism of bondage, through the prism of servitude. Because of course, over and above the question of workers, compensations, etc., we have a complex layer of caste and gender that plays a role in determining who the worker is and what legitimate or illegitimate work becomes. So we have, of course, the fact that women's work or work that comes to be gendered in some ways has, of course, had to grapple with notions of the public and the private. Women's work has been associated, for instance, with unproductiveness, unpaidness, of course, tied to the private domestic sphere. And any sort of extension out of this sphere by women marks their work as illegitimate in some ways. So it doesn't just have to do with work in, say, as a bar dancer or in sex work, but even if you are working as an industrial worker, women's work can become illegitimate because notions of who is the good woman and who is the bad woman can continue to follow you in into these kind of spheres of work. And this is something that unions must grapple with. It is something that we have historically not paid enough attention to, and I think something that came through our discussions was that we really need to start focusing on what are the questions that women workers themselves are facing. As unions, we cannot be merely strategizing about wages, compensation, etc., but we really need to pay attention to what are the specific issues that arise from a gendered notion of work. What is the kind of harassment that women workers face? Is there specific to the gender question itself? And how they must obviously have to attack the idea of what constitutes illegitimate work. On the other hand, we have work that comes marked by a question of caste. Avnish laid out this question really well when talking about agricultural workers and how Dalit workers have always remained landless and tied into certain relations of servitude as a result of that. And what that has meant is that whether it is questions of working conditions or the wage that you receive or don't receive, because of caste operating in that sense, all kinds of servitude can become legitimate in a social sense in that way. So again, unions will have to grapple with this question of attacking the legitimacy of caste-based work in that sense over here to really mark a difference and to bring out the question of the dignity of the worker, which has to be really brought to this, to our focus and attention. Keeping these questions in mind, then, I think we need to think about, and again, our discussions over the last 2 days have pointed to the question of how do we really discuss or how do we think about mobilization of these kind of workers? I think the first question that was raised over the last 2 days and which we can all agree upon is that we also need to, within our own work, focus on the question of how caste and gender marks certain kind of work, and we need to think about our mobilization strategies, the questions we raise through our union work on these questions itself. In order to sort of forge wider alliances, it would be absolutely necessary for us to think about these questions very, very carefully. And also to therefore try and democratize our own functioning, to try and widen the questions on which we can actually come together. And I think this was something that came up yesterday in our session on, you know, living in the cities as well, that when we are talking about the questions of workers and struggles of workers, we really need to broaden our idea of what all can be included in our struggles. And increasingly, because of the kind of onslaught that our workers are facing and our struggles are facing, we need to tie this to all kinds of questions. We need to tie it to questions of housing, we need to tie it to questions of transport, the right to live in the city, the right to a life of dignity in rural villages and rural areas. All of these need to really be brought on board. Linked to this, therefore, I think is a question of, again, if we are to return back to that question of who is the worker, it demands a fundamental rethinking on our part. Not a rethinking, essentially, because we've always, to some extent, discussed the idea of the worker as a citizen, but we really need to bring this into our struggles as well, where therefore we are constituting our working class as a form of the public and as a form of the public that actually has a stake in society itself. So as opposed to being continuously pushed to the margins, if we are to actually move towards the mainstream thinking about in terms of our political action, we really need to work towards the idea of larger citizen struggles, struggles of the public, and we need to do this, I think, primarily first by building alliances between our own unions, whether that is in terms of unions of formal workers and informal workers, or even within informal sector unions. We saw a whole range of unions here. Broader alliances have to be made. And unless we are able to do that, it is going to be increasingly hard for us to sort of push back and to resist. So I think the way ahead has already happened here in our coming together in this kind of session. We can see this as a start to what lies ahead, the path that lies ahead, where we need to tie in with each other, you know, make links here that can hopefully lead a longer, larger struggle ahead. Thank you.